Now that we have all this great geometry that we created in previous lectures, let's create some perspective views. I should mention, by the way, that some people do like to operate Revit in a kind of clean screen mode. This is similar to AutoCAD, where you can hide all the tool palettes and all the toolbars. Obviously, that doesn't make for a very good lesson for me, because you can't see my hands typing in the keyboard shortcuts. So to bring back your toolbars, there's a little button here. That's the Show Full Ribbon button. And if you want sort of a minimal ribbon, you can click on the down arrow, and it kind of condenses everything. But just keep clicking through, and it'll bring back the full ribbon. The other thing is, if you want your properties menu, and I have multiple screens, so I sometimes drag the properties menu onto the other screen. But here I can call it back. You see how it's kind of floating. They call that a floating menu. You can just drag it over the edge of your Revit interface, kind of the vertical edge here, and it should pop right into position. And again, working in a small space of your screen, some people will hide the project browser or close it by mistake. You can just turn it on here. It usually comes in side by side. Again, you can drag the top bar of the project browser. You can either drag it right on top of the properties menu, or you can kind of drag it so that it nests on top of it. And it's a little tricky to kind of get it in the right spot. You have to kind of move your mouse around and drag it over the top of the properties menu, or the bottom if you want it on the bottom. Doesn't really matter, but since we are talking about views, maybe I'll put it on top. And if you do like the clean screen mode, each tool usually has a keyboard shortcut. You can also come in here and take a look at the keyboard shortcuts in a list form. And in fact, there's a keyboard shortcut to access the keyboard shortcut. It's KS. Creating a perspective view is actually pretty easy. There's a little quick button here that you can find. It's the camera tool. And you can do it here in the default 3D view. I'll just click once to place it. See, it even has a cute little icon. And then the second point that you click on is going to be the target. Now, placing it in 3D is a little, it's kind of hard to figure out where you're going with that one. So you can see here, I wasn't exactly sure where I was looking. So the best way to create it is actually go to your ground floor plan view. And here you can see the camera, actually. And here I'm going to tile my windows so that you can see both at the same time. Here is my 3D view, here the actual perspective, and then here is the camera. This camera has a number of features. First of all, I can actually move it here in plan, and you see how the view will change. You can control how far back it crops. So you see how I can drag this crop box, and it will change what I see. So if I don't want to see something in the distance, I just drag that in. Anyway, and then the red thing is the target. So if I want to create something that's a little more, dramatic, I can do it that way. The other thing is perspective views do have properties. And if you go down here, you can change some of these properties. For example, the far clip offset, that was the back of the box. You can change it by dragging it, but I can also type in 100 feet, for example, and it will change how far back the box goes. Not every property allows you to do this, of course, but often we'll create a perspective and you're like, why is it not looking correct? And why is something not showing up that should be? And it's usually that far crop. The other thing is the eye height. See how this is kind of a worm's eye view? I'm really looking down, looking up from a very low angle. That's the eye elevation. And if you remember from SketchUp, there's the eye height feature. Here it's the same thing. If we make this, say, 4 feet, and the target elevation also 4 feet, that should get rid of some of that weirdness that we're seeing. See how it's a little more normal looking perspective. The other thing that we need to discuss here in perspective land is something called the crop region. Now, this crop region, it's a box on the outside of your drawing that allows you to, you guessed it, crop your drawing, kind of like a crop box. Or if you think of AutoCAD, it's like a viewport boundary where you can just control what's seen. This can be turned on and off. And it also can be hidden. So if I check the Do Not Crop View button, and this is the sort of universal crop symbol, if I choose Do Not Crop View, now you can just basically see off into infinity. It's kind of like SketchUp. But the other thing is, if I turn it back on, I can hide or show the actual box. Now note that when you print, the box does not actually show up unless you make a special effort to show it up. So you won't have a border around your drawings unless you change some settings when you export. And actually, surprise, surprise, almost every drawing has these crop regions in them. If we go to floor plan view, and you might say, I don't see any crop regions. Well, guess what? We just learned that they're hidden. You choose Show Crop Region, and there it is. There's my floor plan crop region. And let's say I wanted to do an enlarged plan of just this spiral stair. I could easily, you can split crop regions. That's what I was doing there. You can easily zoom way in and crop the entire rest of the plan and just have this itty bitty little piece here. Now, I don't want to do that. So I'm not going to crop the view, and I'm also going to hide the crop region so that I don't see it. While we are talking about crop regions, two types of drawings that are a little tricky with crop regions are sections and interior elevations. And I'm on the View tab here, and there's the Section tool. If you click on the Section tool, it prompts you to draw a section icon, and that icon indicates you're going to cut the model in two. And when you draw that, if you see this dashed line, this is kind of the section, the crop region that we're going to see, and this determines how much of the section you're going to see. So if I drag it in, I won't see that back wall. Also, if I drag it left or right, see the symbol doesn't move, but I can change what's actually shown. To see the section, you can either just select the section icon, right-click on it, and choose Go to View, or you can dig it out here in the Sections section of the View project browser. Now, in the crop region, this is a three-dimensional crop region. So it was changing how deeply it cut, but also, look at this, it changes how high it cuts. I can make my section remove part of the building or not. And interior elevations actually work kind of the same way. If you go here to the Elevation tool, you can choose Elevation, and Revit has two kinds of elevations, building elevations and interior elevations. So we're inside the building. Let's choose the interior one. And you see how my cursor has a little kind of witch's hat there, which points at the side that's going to be elevated. I already can see this side in my section view, so I only need this opposite side here that's kind of not seen. Similar to the section, I can click on the interior elevation symbol. Now, typically you do show an entire room all the way until you hit the back wall. So I can move where the crop region is so that it shows this entire interior elevation. Let's see what that looks like. Go to elevation view. Now, elevations, interior elevations, Revit, you know, I hate to say it, Revit's just not good at interior elevations. Nobody's perfect. And so I have to crop the ceiling down. You don't see the ceiling in an interior elevation. You also don't see the floor structure. And in fact, you don't even see these symbols here. This is unusual. I should remove it from my view here, just hide the whole category. That's really an interior elevation view. However, the perimeter line should be a lot darker. So I'm just going to right-click on my crop region and override the graphics in view of the element. And now I can make the line style something a little bit darker. I'll make it black, and I'll make the line weight about 6, and apply, and OK. And there we go. That's a much better interior elevation. Just be aware, when you go to create a PDF of this view, you have to uncheck this hide crop boundaries box. Otherwise, that line will disappear because it is still a crop region. But then you just click export like you normally would. Exterior perspectives are fairly straightforward because you can basically have a pretty easy time to place the camera. There's not a lot of stuff in the way. When I click on the crop region in one view, you can see the camera in the other view, and there's nothing out here, so I can move the camera anywhere I want. Interior views, however, are a little more tricky. Interior views are a little more tricky because of all the stuff in the way. So let's create an interior view. And actually, if you go to the View tab, you can create a perspective from here. It's just hidden under the 3D menu. It's the camera tool. Same camera tool. Anyway, and when you create an interior perspective, of course, you do want to think about where you're standing. If I click in one corner and point at the other corner, that's going to be a two-point perspective. If I click right in the center and go straight to the back, that's going to be a one-point perspective. By default, Revit does leave the crop region on and visible, but I'm going to turn it off and make it stop cropping, just to give us a little bit more of a kind of SketchUp look alike here. And be aware that you can zoom in and out through the building. So just like SketchUp, you can walk through walls, or at least you can try. And controlling the view in Revit is a little different. We do have this view cube you can click on, and we saw this in our 3D view. You can kind of pivot the model. But the thing that we have here that's kind of nice is this all-in-one navigation wheel. If you click on that, you'll see that there, let me move it to a blank spot. There's all your usual commands that you expect for zooming. You just click on them and it zooms or pans or orbits around this kind of steering wheel shaped device here. So if I want to orbit, just click and drag where it says orbit, and the base point for the orbit is where the tool is. It also has the look tool, which is kind of like in SketchUp. You can look up, right? And we can create a worm's eye or bird's eye view this way. So for example, if I wanted to look up, but then move my camera down, you see how I can just go down really low. And that sometimes is a really dramatic perspective view. And these are so much easier to create on the computer than drawing by hand. So all of those are standard commands. And then if you're like, oh, I've totally messed this up, there's a rewind button. Just click and drag, and it will take you backwards through all the steps that you made. Be aware that you can have a very long rewind history. Also in that steering wheel, you'll see there are a number of other tools here. There's a teeny tiny little down arrow. And if you click on that, first of all, you can make the navigation wheel into the mini touring wheel. And there's other wheels that you can choose. There are some fun tools. You can level the camera, which is in case you've orbited your model and your eye height is different than your target height. There are also the ability to orient to specific views. This is great when you go to create, say, a section perspective. Finally, you can also choose things like increasing and decreasing the focal length. And this is particularly important for interiors where we tend to have a very wide field of view. So if I choose this option and I click and drag, you see how I'm kind of moving away from the model, but actually what's happening is it's swapping my camera lenses. I'll hit Escape to stop changing that focal length. And now when I zoom in, things are actually somewhat more distorted because I've changed that focal length. It does, things are starting to look like a little too distorted, but just to rewind so you can see what it looks like here in the difference, go back a little bit, that it tends to flatten it when you go the opposite direction. And that's more typical of an exterior perspective, a more flat perspective. The other thing to talk about here is view composition. You typically want to have a nice balance of floor, ceiling, and then the walls that are visible in your project. So I have orbited and rotated this model here using my tool to get a nice view of the project where you see there's a kind of balance of space on the right, a balance of space on the left. Perhaps it's a little too far to the right. And then I also want to have a balance of floor and ceiling. That tends to look the best. The other thing that tends to look better is that level camera. The unlevel camera, when you've orbited, see these vertical edges? They're actually going to a vanishing point way up above. my screen. And choosing the level camera option will get rid of that. And that is what we've referred to as an architectural camera or architectural perspective. And that's generally what you want to do. See, and that looks a little neater. You may have to pan up or down, and you may have to zoom in or out to get your view composition back to where you like it. With the composition all set, let's look at some graphical controls. Now, basically, there are some simple visual display options. Right now, we're in hidden line mode. Wireframe is fairly self-explanatory. Everything becomes unsolid. You can also shade the view, and we have looked at this before, on the outside. And what this does is it applies a kind of global material to every sort of object. And in this menu, there are some other things we can do. I'm going to go back to hidden line view and go to the graphic display options. It's at the top of this menu. And here there's a couple other things that we can do. We can choose those same menu items, but we can also kind of add transparency to all sorts of objects. So instead of being 100% hidden line or 100% X-ray kind of view, we can kind of make it semi-transparent. These can be interesting views of your model, and they can show all sorts of detail. They can kind of suggest at things that are adjacent to your project. And that's one way. We can also do this same sort of control item by item. That was the entire view. Let's say I want this wall to have some transparency to it. I can just right-click on it. And remember, before we learned we can hide elements or entire categories. I wouldn't want to do the category because those are walls and all my walls would disappear. But if I hide the element, it disappears. Right below that, I can override the graphics by element. And this does something similar to that previous menu. Among other things, I can just go here to the surface transparency and make it more transparent. And again, this is a nice way to kind of show that the object is in the space, but have it not be distracting in the overall view. So back in the graphic display options, there's a number of other things we can do. Shadows are a fun one. You can cast shadows and you can show ambient shadows. And what this does is it kind of adds, particularly the ambient shadows, adds something called ambient occlusion, which is an effect where you tend to see darkness kind of pool in the corners and along edges of a space. Just adds a sense of realism. And particularly for black and white views, this is a nice way to give some depth to your project without having to deal with either materials or lighting. The other thing that you can do is add in sketchy lines. Now, I will say, I think SketchUp's sketchy lines are much sketchier. They're also just a lot nicer. Like, these are kind of a little scratchy, and their line weights are not well represented. But you can see it's, again, an effect that is kind of nice. I will say that if you really want the sketchy look and you want more control, you want it to actually look like hand or pen drawings, for example, I would just export your model or part of your model, if it's a big model, export it to a file format that SketchUp can read, which is the DWG file format. And then you can just open it in SketchUp, apply materials like you normally would, and you can get that sketchy effect. I put this back in the ambient mode. I turned off shadows because indoors, shadows make the room a little on the dark side. So where are all these 3D views? Well, if you go to your project browser and you open up this folder called 3D views, you'll see that there are two of them. If I just double click on one, this is the exterior view. This is the bottom one is the interior view. And in the project browser, you can just click on this and type in a new name. If you want, I think it gets pretty complicated pretty quickly in most projects. You usually have a lot of views, so you might want to be more specific than just outdoor and indoor view because you may have dozens. However, the one that's a little tricky is this 3D view. This is the default one. And for this next little trick I want to show you, I want to make a copy of this default view. Now, this is an axonometric view, and I can just right-click on it and duplicate the view. Now, duplicate with detailing is an option here. Duplicate or duplicate with detailing. The latter allows you, if there are any notes or any dimension strings, those will go with you. But I'm just going to go and duplicate it. And I'm going to call the new one exploded view. And the reason is that Revit allows you a fun technique called a displacement view. Now, I'm going to hide all sorts of other elements in this view. I'm just going to select them using the Modify tool and the crossing window so that I can hide all this stuff that I don't want to see. Once you've cleaned everything up, you can come in and select, say, one of the walls. And remember, by the way, you can hit Tab if you're having trouble getting the exact item that you're looking for. Anyway, select the object, and up here in the Modify toolbar, there's an option called Displace Elements. And this only works with selected objects, but it kind of allows you, in this view only, to pull the building apart. And this can be really interesting. For example, in this building, maybe I want to show the inside of the building, but I don't have an easy way to do that using a perspective. Maybe I want an axonometric view. You can do this, by the way, in perspective view. Axonometric is just a little clearer, I think, in the way it looks. But this is kind of a nice way to just show off some interesting interior and exterior features. I guess I left these windows out. I could grab these as well. The other thing that you can do is once you've created this displacement view, you can add in little lines that are kind of projection lines that show where the object came from. So if I move my mouse over the edge of, say, this, see how it adds in some lines. I could even add in one in the front, and I could do that in the same with this building here. Maybe I'll do it this way. Again, you don't want to be too confusing. Like, this is maybe a little confusing, but I think it does show where the building came from. And these are really fun and interesting views. And again, you're just trying to show the relationship of elements. It has no effect on any other 3D views. However, remember that I did duplicate this default 3D view in order to get this. If you change your original 3D view, well, then you've done it. You'll have to undo back to get out of that displacement view. One display mode we have not talked about yet is realistic mode. And when you turn on realistic mode, you might not see a lot of change because there may not be that many materials in your project. However, this is where you'll see it when you do add materials. To add materials, go to the Modify toolbar, and you'll see a little option here, a teeny tiny little item, which is a circle with an arrow to a box. And that is the Paint tool. If you just click on it, you can also type in PT for Paint. That brings up the Paint menu with all the different materials in the project. And right now, you'll see there's not a whole lot, but there's a couple, and enough to allow us to do some basic things. So for example, if I choose Brick Common, now move your mouse over a surface, you see how it highlights these different surfaces. You can't paint on displaced elements in this view, but I can just click, and like magic, I've got brick on the wall. And this should feel pretty familiar compared to other programs. I can paint carpet on the floor. Now, let's say I want to paint all the exterior walls. I want them to have brick on either side. Well, that's a little more complicated. Many objects, you can do what I just did, which is just paint really by clicking on the surface. But a lot of objects, you have to paint in other ways. So a brick wall, let's select one of the walls and get its properties. We've done this before. Oops, we'll have to select one of the main walls. Choose Edit Type. And now, to change the material, you actually have to come out and look in the menu and see if you can find something that says Materials. Now, right here, it's saying the material is by category. So, and it's the structural material. So we have to go and edit the structure here to change the material. You have to dig into the menu and change the material when you click in this cell, you should see the little ellipsis, the three dots, and then you can come in and choose that brick material that we were choosing before. This is the same menu. Oh, not brick soldier course. I think there's another brick. Yeah, brick common. That's what we'll use. Okay. And now we have painted the wall, even though it sure doesn't feel like it. See how it changes all the walls, including the ones that we couldn't paint because they were displaced. So some objects are painted that way. Other objects, if you go and you get their properties, you'll find that there's a field either here in the instance properties, or like we did before, you might see materials and finishes listed here. And you can come in here and there's an option to pick a different color. Let's say stainless steel, and okay, and apply, and okay. And what you'll see is whatever it was that we just changed should change to stainless steel. So if you can't change the wall materials in the instance properties or the family type properties, sometimes you have to go and edit a component. Now this was our in-place component here. You actually have to go and edit the component and create that material parameter. And to do that, you just edit in place. So now you're editing this object here. And what you can do is you can select pieces of the object and give them a material parameter. Just go down, I've selected some masses here, and I can come in and change their material. There aren't a lot of materials in here right now, but I think there was an oak. Well, we'll use oak flooring because it's handy for that. And the other thing is I can come in, and you can see immediately it changes. I can hold down Control, select all of these handrails, and again, it's a mass. In a mass, you can apply a material directly and just go down and we'll choose chrome. Chrome looks good. Okay. And there you go. When you finish your model, you've done it correctly. Finally, if you need to make a change to an object that was created as a separate family, like this one, you'll have to double click to edit it like we did before, but now you're back in the family and you can come in and change the materials here as you see fit. You should note, however, that there aren't nearly as many materials in here. So you won't have all the materials we saw in the previous model. So you may end up having to create a new material. I'm going to just choose glass for now and OK. And then I'm going to load this into the project. And it will give you an option to save before you do. And of course, I do want to save because I want to overwrite it. Now, this is the instance where I do want to overwrite the existing version and its parameter values, because one of its parameters is that it should be made of glass. And there you go, you can see it's made of glass. So what if you've added a material to, say, a wall, and I've added to this to the structure of the wall, I made it some kind of wood, but maybe I want one little area to be a different material. Well, Revit has provided us something called split face. And this will allow you to draw a small area that's a different material than the rest of the area just by sketching the profile of the area that you want. So I'll click split face. This is going to change this model item, so it will change in every view. This isn't like the displacement view where it changes in just that one view. I'll click on this face, and you see how the rest of the model gets grayed out. And again, I'll just draw, like in the little video, I'll draw an area that's like a panel and click plus. And you might say, well, I just see a line there. Well, now when I call up my paint bucket, I can come in and I can paint it. Here, we'll paint it some material like copper. And there you go. You've got yourself an area that's a different floor. And you can do this on pretty much any surface. The trick is, if you wanted to, say, have an area on the top of this desk that was a different material, you would actually have to go and edit the family. Okay, so now you want to make new materials, don't you? Because all the materials in here are boring. Well, what you can do is go to the Manage tab, and you'll find the Materials library. And this is the library where, or the materials browser, where you can find all the information about the materials that are in your project. Okay, and you can sort this by materials by their type of family that they are, or the type of material grouping. You can also just show ones that are in use. Obviously, that's going to be a shorter list. You might say, well, I don't remember using lightweight concrete. Well, a lot of these materials are actually used inside families. For example, they may be inside a floor or wall family. So to make a new material, there's basically an option here. You can either create an entirely new material. I'm clicking on the little plus sign down here. Entirely new material, or you can duplicate a material that's already existing. And I'm going to start from scratch. Just it allows us to discuss all the different features. The first thing is it's called default new material. Totally lame name. We should give it a new name. I would recommend either typing in an underscore first so that it shows up at the top of your list, or if you're like me and your initials are AB, that'll show up at the top of the list as well. I think I'll use underscore to be a little more universal. And I'm going to call this new material wall paint, and I'll make it green. And you can also give it a class, which is kind of the type of thing that it is. And you can either have a direct paint or a paint and coating. I'm going to just choose paint. And that allows Revit to sort it. There also is the ability to generate schedules based on area of surfaces that are painted that paint color. And that's awfully handy if you're ordering paint. Anyway, there are three tabs here. There's the graphics tab. And I'll stretch this out a little bit so we can see what it looks like. And the graphics tab basically has some features of the shaded view of the material. So for example, if the shaded material, usually it uses the render appearance, but let's say I have applied this material and I want to make it really recognizable that I've applied it. Like I'm not sure that it's working. I'm gonna click OK and apply. And okay, and I'm going to paint one of these walls that material, and then I'll shade the view in order to make it visible. And you can see here when it's in rendered view, when it's in the realistic view, I can't see that I've made that wall green. But now if I go to shaded view, any wall with that paint color should be bright green. Again, just a way to kind of check the way it looks. We rarely use these shaded views in our presentations, but they are awfully nice when you want to check and see if a material is actually working. So back in the materials menu, I am going to use the render appearance. If there were other reasons that I needed to modify these other things, these are all things which apply in non-rendered views. So surface pattern, I can add a texture to it or whatever. All of those are non-rendered views. The render appearance, that's the last tab. And this is actually the one that we are usually most excited about, because this is what it looks like when you run your rendering engine and make your model look more photorealistic. Now the default material, and I'm just going to stretch this little preview out, is not all that exciting looking. It's actually kind of yucky. And that's because they're basically, it's just painted gray. If we want to add a new material, the simplest way is to go to the materials library, and there's a replace this asset button. Click on that and you'll end up with the asset browser. Of course, if you have a big computer screen, this is awfully nice. If you have a small computer screen, this is kind of no fun at all. And what you'll see is there's a number of different materials libraries. We're going to just use this appearance library. And the reason is because these look good. We don't want to use the other materials because they don't look so good. And it's organized in a fairly logical manner. So for example, if I wanted to come in here under paint, I can go for, I don't know, some unusual paint colors. Or if I just click on this, it should have some fairly basic paint colors in here. So for example, maybe I want to make the paint color kind of a green. And you can stretch these out if you want to find out a little bit more about it. Like, oh, that's a metal flake. I'm not sure I totally want a metal flake. But, well, let's go with metallic, just for the fun of it. And I'm going to double-click on the asset. And what that does is it takes it from the library which is a separate place, and brings it onto your computer. And now you can see my material has this look to it that's kind of metallic. It's kind of shiny. And you can make this bigger, obviously, like I just did. And then you can also, there's all sorts of other fun things you can do in this preview window. They will slow your computer down depending on what you choose. So for example, if I chose a draped fabric, it will show me what this material looks like on a table. The other fun thing that you can do is you can change some of the features of this material. And there are things like reflectance, roughness. Here I'll drag roughness way down, and you should see fairly quickly what that looks like. Again, a lot of this is going to depend on the power of your processor. The other thing is you can check the render settings here and go to production quality, and that will definitely take a little bit more time. But if you're tweaking your materials, it's actually nice to do. I usually leave it in the slower setting because otherwise the fan starts to go bananas on my computer. So the other thing is you can have other lighting conditions, for example, a plaza, and you can imagine that the lighting outside as opposed to inside, grid light might be more of an interior type of lighting. And you can see in realistic view that gives you some interesting kind of reflective qualities to the wall, maybe a little peculiar, maybe better for something metallic. Now, once you've made a material, you can duplicate your own material. So let's say I wanted green and red. I can actually just duplicate this material and its assets. And what you'll see here, up at the very top of my new material, first of all, I can change its name by just calling it something else here in the properties menu. We'll call it red. You'll also see that in both of these materials, if you go to the appearance tab, one says this is the asset here. That's what the little hand with the, I don't know what that is. But this means it's metallic green. It's actually making reference to that original material back in the library. Whereas the red one, it's making use of a copy of that asset. And this is important because if you don't do that, if you don't duplicate this asset, then you'll end up changing both of these materials. If you've forgotten to do that, you can just click this Duplicate This Asset button, and now you have a different asset that's associated with this new color. And you can just come in here and change the color and have just a party with color. And as you can see, you can really get some tweakiness here. You can have base colors that are different and highlight colors, but it's basically a copy of the original. So what if I want a totally new material that's not based on the asset library, that's based on maybe a picture of a fabric from the internet? Well, go to the internet and get yourself a seamless texture. And we've used this before in SketchUp and in also Photoshop and Illustrator. A seamless texture is basically an image which is created to have the left and right side matching one another. And there are plenty of fabrics and things in the asset library, but I want to show you how to make a custom one. So I'm going to create a new material like we did before. We'll start by changing the name. And I like to start with that just so I can find it later on. And I'll call this wallpaper. And in the finishes here, you can, I don't know what probably textile would be the most logical thing. Yeah, it doesn't really make a difference if you change that for the most part. But anyway, I always check the use render appearance. And the reason is because I frequently will operate in shaded mode. And so I like it to match so that I can have a sense of what I'm looking at. And this also, shaded mode is faster than the realistic mode. Your computer will absolutely start to hum and maybe even smoke when you are rendering several views all at the same time with that realistic view. So anyway, put them in shaded view. Doesn't make for a very good video though. Anyway, in this view here, I have my basic material. But I don't have an image. The way that you get an image is you click on the little box that says image. I know that's hard to imagine. And I have mine saved in a in a kind of folder on a library on my computer, but you can absolutely save these in a folder for your project, and I would strongly recommend that. Especially if you're working on one of the desktop computers, all you have to do is copy your project folder over, either by emailing it to yourself or by logging into Google Drive, and then you have all of your materials, and in fact, Revit may even remember where they are. Sometimes you have to relink them. But basically, you choose the material. Here, I'll choose, let's choose a carpet texture here. Once you've added the material, you actually can come back in and edit the image, or even just remove it and put a new one in here. If you edit the image, what you'll see is a submenu pops up. Again, this is typical of Revit, a lot of submenus. You can actually change the size of the image as the computer thinks it is, and it gives a nice little preview up here. So if it's 1 foot by 1 foot and you think that it's misscaled on the internet, you can absolutely change that. You can also change whether or not it tiles. So let's say you just want a single image planted in the middle of a wall, but you don't necessarily want many copies of it. You can tell it not to tile. Anyway, that's the base image. And then you get into the properties of the image. So for example, you can have highlights, you can have glossiness, and yes, carpets can be glossy, but if it looks too glossy, you can drag that down. You can also control some other things, for example, reflectivity. If I turn this on, it can have some reflectivity. See how it kind of changed the upper portion of it? And let's make this a higher render setting so that we can really get a sense of what these changes do. Of course, it is a problem because I'm running out of menu space here. Each of these can be activated just by clicking the box. So in addition to reflectivity and transparency, which are fairly self-explanatory, let me show you a cutout option here, cutout property. And what I did, I made a copy of our carpet texture that has a couple different features to it. And the way I did that, I opened it in my handy-dandy photo editor, Photoshop. And here's my carpet layer right in the background. And I made one copy that's just in black and white. And this is really good, really handy when you're really tweaking materials. I can make a black and white version that will allow me to make it seem bumpy. But the other thing I did, I'll turn all these guys off, and I turned on a layer. I just put in some text. Okay, and that's what I'm going to do right now back in the material. So I'll choose the text, cut it out, and what you'll see is it's actually made little cuts. I can't quite zoom in on these, but I can make them a little bigger. It's cut out the bit that is black. Anything that is white, it leaves opaque. And if I go and edit the image, I can change the size of the image. I don't know, let's make it 4 feet by 4 feet. Interesting enough, this is the one menu where everything is in inches, not in feet. You can also change the position. I'll move it over, I don't know, maybe 9 inches and minus 9 inches. It's an XYZ plane, but I'm just trying to get it so you can get it on the corner here, and you can start to see that it's made a hole where that pattern was. And this is great if you're making something like wire mesh or a fence. And there are wire mesh and fence materials in the asset library, but sometimes we want to customize it, or we have something like 3form, which has a transparency with some objects inside it. You want to cut out around those objects. Anyway, this process is called using a map. So it's a texture map for different features. I think I'll cut out the cut it out map now. Just turn that off. Another one that we'll get to when we get to lighting is self-illumination, but the other one that we use a lot for finished materials is bump. And again, the materials that we're going to be using, if we get them from the asset library, which is of course the easiest, they usually have a bump map associated with them. In my case, I'm going to use this black and white version of my carpet texture. And by the way, I'm looking at this as thumbnails. If your computer is not showing them as thumbnails, but maybe as a list, you'll have to change it. So you can see, you may be a list kind of person, but I'm going to go with thumbnails. All right, choose the black and white image, And what you can do, you can immediately see that the preview gets a little bumpier, I guess you could say. And of course, if I raise the render settings to production quality, you'll see that bumpiness increase. And then the other thing is I can adjust the bumpiness to stick out even more. You can also make it go the other direction. If you move it past the center point, see how the numbers become negative? It can look bumpy going the other way. And you kind of have to experiment. Every texture is a little different. But you can see this looks like a bumpy carpet. And once you hit apply and OK down through the cascade of menus, it becomes a material that you can paint anywhere in your project. And like I mentioned, I put the underscore or my initials at the top here. That just makes it easy in the paint menu to find the surface that I want to paint. And there you go. You have yourself a nice carpet material. What if you want to use an image in your project, but you want to use just one instance of the image, something like a painting or a carpet? Well, good old Revit has an option for you. If you go here on the insert menu, there's something called a decal. And a decal is kind of like a sticker. You can create a decal, and I'm going to go here to the decal types menu first because I don't have any created. And what you do is you basically create a sticker with the image you want to use. There's a create new decal button. Just click on that, and I'll call this one painting. And the way it works is you go and you grab an image file. Up here at the top, there's a source for that image. Click to browse, and I've downloaded a Alphonse Mucha poster here. And then you can control a couple of features about it, whether or not it is how bright it is, and also how glossy the surface is. And this is important because once you start adding electric lighting, it will look like it's, say, behind glass. You can also make it glow a little bit, and this is nice if you want something to look like it's a illuminated TV screen. You just get yourself an image of a TV screen and then make it a CRT television, which is an old style school. It's kind of funny that they still have that. It's actually just the amount of illuminance that it has. Anyway, you can add bump to it and other things, cutouts, but for the most part, we tend to use this just as an image. Click OK, and now when you go to create, place the decal, just click the Place Decal button. And generally, it goes right onto a face that is a flat face. Typically, it goes onto a vertical face. Once it's placed here, you can change the size of the image just by grabbing the grips and make it larger or smaller. And if you want something like a frame around this, you'd have to do that with probably a component in place and make a sweep or something like that. These decals do tend to look a little flat when you put them on the wall, especially when you run the view through a renderer like Enscape. And even if you just turn on the shadows, and down here, there's a single button that allows you to turn on the shadows. It looks like a sun with a shadow on it, I guess is what the icon looks like. But it basically looks like a sticker on the wall. One little trick to get around that is create a little kind of plinth to put the decal on. I'm going to put a Persian carpet down here on the ground. I created a decal. Oops, saved the project. I created a decal for Persian carpet, and then I made this little square of flooring that's about a half an inch above the floor level. And when I place the decal on top of that, it will stick up above the floor ever so slightly. And this will allow the shadow to be created by the decal, and it just makes it look a little nicer. The one trick with this, though, is you do have to actually size the floor to the decal. So if you haven't done that, you'll have to go grab the floor. You see here it's just a generic. I just used a generic floor with the height offset of half an inch. And I actually created a little half-inch generic floor for myself. So you'll have to make it a little bigger in order to have it fit the decal. And then you'll get a nice little shadow, and this you'll definitely notice this when you use this in a renderer like Enscape. One annoying thing about Revit is there's not a particularly good library of components. However, there is a great library of components in SketchUp. It's that 3D warehouse. And guess what? You can use these objects in Revit. There's a little bit of a trick, though. If you just bring in an object from the 3D warehouse directly, it doesn't always take materials very well. So I went and I grabbed this chair off of 3D warehouse, and to make it work in Revit, you have to do a few things. First of all, you have to go and make sure that every part of your model that wants to be a different material, and here you can see there's some cushions and there's this wood base, everyone needs to be on its own tag. If you remember from the old days, tags in SketchUp are kind of like layers. I'll turn off the cushion layer and you can see the cushions go away. I can turn off the wood frame layer and the wood frame goes away. And there's nothing on the untagged layer, so I can't turn that off. So you have to make sure that everything's on those layers. And the other thing you want to do is make sure, and having subgroups, make sure that the group itself is on that layer. And of course, I'm going to select this and go here and make sure that this is on wood frame. And this one here is on the cushion layer. I also believe that the objects inside those groups are on the correct tag. And the way Revit works, it will dig through and find the innermost tag. And that's the one that's kind of the governing one. Anyway, the other thing you have to do is you have to delete all the materials. And you might say, well, wait a second, I like the materials. But they don't work in Revit. So you can just go to this flyout menu here in the materials model. Oops. Make sure that you're showing the materials in the model. And just purge or delete all of the materials in the model. And you'll see the model turns white. And, you know, of course, it's a little disconcerting because you don't want it to be white. You want to have materials. But as long as there are tags in there, Revit will know what to do. So save your model and then go back to Revit. And on the insert menu, you have an option here. This is convenient. Just there with the decals, you can import a CAD file. However, what I'm going to do is I'm going to link the CAD file. This is a great option when you're doing SketchUp models because sometimes they don't work the way you want. And you do have to tell it, look for SketchUp files. It can look for AutoCAD files, and it can, there's all sorts of other things, Formit, OBJ, which are 3D print files, Rhino files. Anyway, we're going to choose SketchUp file. I'm going to choose that chair. The other thing that you want to do is normally the positioning, it just does it itself. It does it automatically. I prefer to do manual from the center of the object. Or from the origin of the object, actually, probably even better, but I'll show you what the center does. And the reason I do this is because sometimes SketchUp objects are not close to the origin. And if you didn't check, it could be way out in outer space, and then you'd spend a long time trying to find it. This way, your cursor should be right in the middle of the chair, and you can just click to place it. There may be a warning error message because sometimes there's geometry that SketchUp has that Revit does not like. And there is my beautiful model in all its uncolored glory. And by the way, if you wanted this piece of furniture to show up in schedules and whatnot, you could actually create a new standalone furniture family and put the SketchUp model inside that. I'm just going to put it directly in the model because I only have a one-off. To paint the material, you actually have to go to the Manage ribbon, and there's a special way. SketchUp objects cannot be painted directly, nor can they be painted through their properties. Here on the Manage menu, go to Object Styles. And this is a special menu that allows you to kind of override any objects, object family in the whole project. You can make all your doors, for example, a certain material. Now, in our case, we're not going to do that. What we are going to do is go to Imported Objects. There's a tab up here. And you should see any imported objects in your model. And here you go. Here are the tags that we saw in SketchUp. And then you can just go to the material category here, the material column, click inside the cell, and now there's a picker that brings up the materials menu, and lo and behold, you can choose your materials. And I created one for the cushion and one for the wood, I think, on the frame. And like magic, it should color your chair. And just assign them and OK and hit apply and you should be good. There you go. Now, one thing I will say, it's not a perfect solution, and I tend to use solid colors when I'm painting SketchUp objects, and here is the reason why. If you look at the materials, it looks fine on the side, but on the front, it's having a little bit of an issue. Now, this, I've heard, can be an issue with the direction of the faces in SketchUp, and one thing you can do is create a material that's rotated 90 degrees and put that on the front of the cushion, and it gets very, very complex. Better to just paint it a solid material and have a material swatch nearby, but at least you can get the color fairly close. And of course, solid materials, it's not an issue if it's a solid color. And any tweaks you make to the material, the wood, for example, if you change the scale of the wood, the grain should appear at a different scale. And those SketchUp objects, generally, they can be quite handy because they're such a large furniture library, even if the materials are sometimes a little tricky. And what's nice, when you export a PDF, you can get all those materials to show up. Just when you do export a shaded or realistic view like this, check off raster processing. And again, I'm gonna fit to my large sheet size here. And that'll give you a really nice quality image with fairly detailed detailed materials. So in summary, we learned how to create perspectives and all sorts of other views, exploded axonometric views, and also elevations and sections. And also that every view has its own unique view properties, including things like scale, but also the visibility of objects and of whole categories of objects can be modified, controlled, and objects can even be overridden or hidden entirely.